Hello everyone, myself Shivangi Mishra, and today we are going to discuss about the anti-nutritional factor in food. Welcome to all on our YouTube channel, Food Tech Network. So let's start our today's session in which we will discuss about the anti-nutritional factor of a food. What is the anti-nutritional factor? What is the different characteristic of anti-nutritional factors? And what is the effect of that anti-nutritional factor on a human health, and how can we review our impact of that particular anti-nutritional factor? All these topics is discussed in this session. So शुरू से लेके अंत तक हमारे साथ बने रहिए इस session में सारे topic को one by one discuss करने के लिए. आगे बढ़ने से पहले हम यहाँ पे आपको अपनी website के बारे में बताना चाहेंगे. जो है आपका फूड टेक नेटवर्क www.foodtechnetwork.in, इसका लिंक आपको डिस्क्रिप्शन में मिल जाएगा. यहाँ पे अभी मैं आपका इंटरफेस भी दिखा दूंगी कि किस तरीके की चीज़ें हैं. यहाँ पे आपको जो चीज़ें मिलेंगी वो है आपके बुक्स का कलेक्शन है. यहाँ पे फूड टेक्नोलॉजी के डिफरेंट बुक, फूड एनालिसिस मैनुअल्स, ठीक है. उसके अलावा आपको मिलेंगे यहाँ पे डिफरेंट टाइप के एग्जाम रिलेटेड गाइडेंस नोट्स एंड अदर आपके जितने भी हैं ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम, जॉब से रिलेटेड जितने भी हैं आपकी क्वेरीज, जॉब रिलेटेड वैकेंसीज, ये सारी आप यहाँ से जाके चेक कर सकते हैं. मैं एक बार ये आपको यहाँ का इंटरफेस दिखाना चाहूँगी. ये है हमारी साइट का, वेबसाइट का आपका इंटरफेस. यहाँ पे आपको आप जैसे कि देख सकते हैं स्क्रीन पे, होम, ट्रेनिंग एंड जॉब्स, बुक्स, यहाँ पे हैं डिफरेंट ऑप्शंस. यहाँ पे आपको यहाँ पे अगर आपको व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप ज्वाइन करना है जॉब के लिए तो यहाँ पे है. यहाँ पे डायरेक्ट लिंक दिया गया है, वहाँ कर सकते हैं. बाकी आपके पास यहाँ पे मेजर कलेक्शन ऑफ डिफरेंट बुक्स मिलेंगे जो बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट है आपके एग्जाम पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से. तो यहाँ से आप जाके उसको चेकअप कर सकते हैं, फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट है. यहाँ पे आपको फ्री PDF के बुक मिलेंगे. उसके अलावा आपको डिफरेंट टाइप के टाइम टू टाइम ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम्स आते रहते हैं जिनकी भी इंफॉर्मेशन यहाँ पे आपको मिलेगी. आप चाहें तो ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम्स आप ज्वाइन कर सकते हैं. उसके अलावा आपको जो हमारे फूड टेक के लेक्चर हैं ऑलरेडी यूट्यूब पे पहले, वो भी यहाँ से आप एक्सेस कर सकते हैं. और उसके अलावा जितने भी जॉब है फूड इंडस्ट्री से रिलेटेड, कितने ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम्स हैं, कॉलेजेस, इन सारी की इंफॉर्मेशन, मतलब एक कम्प्लीट आपका कह सकते हो स्टॉप डेस्टिनेशन है जहाँ पे आपको सारी चीज़ें आपको मिलेंगी वेल ऑर्गेनाइज फॉर्म में. आपको कहीं इधर उधर जाने की ज़रूरत नहीं है. तो ज़रूर इस वेबसाइट को चेकआउट करिए. ओके, देन कम टू द आवर मेन पॉइंट जो हम डिस्कस करेंगे. ओके, बेसिकली व्हाट इज अ एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर. सो जैसा कि हमारा टॉपिक ही है आज का एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर, सो स्टार्ट विद द इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट. व्हाट इज द एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर. सो एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर, एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर आर दोज कंपाउंड व्हिच इज फाउंड इन अ मोस्ट फूड सब्सटेंस व्हिच आर डिन्यूट्रियस टू ह्यूमन और इन द सेम वे लिमिट द न्यूट्रिएंट availability to the body. That means any substance basically which is found in a food substance which is a deleterious, which is a in a sometime may be fatal or may be in a other way it limit the certain nutrient availability in the body. So these factor is known as a anti-nutritional factor. जैसे कि नाम ही है आपका एंट्री एंड न्यूट्रिएंट. That means न्यूट्रियट के अगेंस्ट जो है, दैट मीन्स जो आपके न्यूट्रियट के अवेलेबिलिटी को लिमिट कर रहा है या फिर उस जो न्यूट्रियट है वो प्रॉपर फॉर्म में आपको मिलेगा नहीं, या फिर अगर आप उस न्यूट्रियट को कंज्यूम करते हैं तो आपके बॉडी के लिए अच्छा नहीं होगा, नॉट गुड फॉर योर हेल्थ. सो जैसे कि नाम में ही लिखा हुआ है एंटर न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर, दैट मीन्स ऐसा कंपोनेंट जो ऐसा कंपाउंड जो आपके न्यूट्रिशन के बियॉन्ड एडवर्स इफेक्ट शो करता है आपके न्यूट्रिशन पे, ठीक है. जो आपके एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर होते हैं, दीज एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर आर ऑल्सो नोन एज अ सेकेंडरी मेटाबोलाइट्स सो इन प्लांट एंड दे हैव बीन शोन टू बी हाईली बायोलॉजिकल एक्टिव एंड प्लांट इवॉल्व दीज सब्सटेंसेज टू प्रोटेक्ट देम सेल्स एंड टू प्रिवेंट देम फ्रॉम बीइंग ईटेन सो दैट मीन्स द सेकेंडरी मेटाबोलाइट्स आर सेकेंडरी कंपाउंड प्रोड्यूस द साइड प्रोडक्ट्स ऑफ प्रोसेसिंग लीडिंग टू द सिंथेसिस ऑफ प्राइमरी मेटाबोलाइट्स सो बेसिकली एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर आपके सेकेंडरी मेटाबोलाइट्स की तरह वर्क करते हैं एंड ये हाई इनकी जो बायोलॉजिकल एक्टिविटी होती है बायोलॉजिकली बहुत हाईली एक्टिव होते हैं एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर ये प्लांट प्रोटीन प्लांट बेस्ड फूड में आपको देखने को मिलते हैं तो इस स्लाइड से जो इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट था वहाँ से आपकी अंडरस्टैंडिंग क्लियर हुई होगी कि वॉट इज द एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर ओके देन कम टू द नेक्स्ट पॉइंट एंड Let's look at the definition of this. So, what is the main definition? हमने वहाँ पे बस जनरल इंट्रोडक्शन देखा कि किसे हम एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर बोल सकते हैं बट देर आर जिस स्पेसिफिक डिफिनीशन गिवन बाई सर्टेन साइंटिस्ट गिवन बाई सर्टेन एजेंसीज जो आपके फूड एंड फूड सेफ्टी रेगुलेशन को मेनटेन करती हैं तो वॉट इज दैट डिफिनीशन एग्जैक्टली क्या है वो हम देख लेते हैं तो डेफिनेशन में आपका देखने को मिलेगा दीज आर द सब्सटेंस जनरेटेड इन अ नेचुरल फूड स्टफ बाय द नॉर्मल मेटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ स्पीसीज एंड बाय डिफरेंट मैकेनिज्म इंक्लूडिंग इनएक्टिवेशन ऑफ सम न्यूट्रिएंट डिमिनिशन ऑफ डाइजेस्टिव प्रोसेस और मेटाबॉलिक यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ फीड विच एग्जर्ट इफेक्ट कॉन्ट्रेरी टू द ऑप्टिमम न्यूट्रिशन सो ऐसे सब्सटेंस जो किसी फूड से जनरेट होते हैं नॉर्मल मेटाबॉलिज्म of that species in different mechanism wo mechanism kya kya ho sakte hain inactivation of some nutrient diminution of digestive process or metabolic utilization of a particular feed particular food so agar inka kuch contrary effect hota hai optimum nutrition pe that means us product mein aapke kuch anti nutritional factor is available or aise anti nutritional factor ki body mein jate hain to aapke different mechanism किसी न्यूट्रिएंट का इनएक्टिवेशन कर देते हैं डाइजेस्टिव प्रोसेस में कुछ डिमिनेशन हो सकता है या फिर मेटाबॉलिक यूटिलाइजेशन उस फूड का प्रॉपर नहीं हो पाए ओके दीज कंपाउंड विच कॉज एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल इफेक्ट एंड एंटी फिजियोलॉजिकल इफेक्ट सच एज इम्पेयर्ड रिप्रोडक्टिव फंक्शन ऑल्सो सो सेकेंडली दीज सब्सटेंस रिड्यूस फीड इनटेक इन एनिमल्स सो दीज आर द डेफिनेशन होप इट्स क्लियर टू यू नाउ come to the next point which is the anti-nutrient what is the anti-nutrient anti-nutrient are a chemical substance which reduce the maximum utilization of nutrient especially protein vitamins and minerals these thus preventing optimal exfoliation of the nutrient present in the food and decreasing the nutritive value of that food As I previously discussed that entry nutrients means anything that is against the nutrient. Okay, so entry nutrient are the chemical substance. Basically, these substance when come to our body, they reduce the maximum utilization of that any particular nutrient, including protein, vitamins, minerals, and thus preventing optimal exfoliation of that nutrient. That means if you consume that particular food which is rich in anti nutritional factor or which have the anti nutrient compound after feeding they are resist the utilization and absorption of different nutritional factor including protein vitamins and minerals and when the special nutrient like protein, vitamin, and minerals not absorb properly by our body, then our body show different kind of deficiency related to protein deficiency, related to vitamin deficiency, maybe in minerals deficiency, and so on. And there is a many health issues is generated due to that anti-nutritional factor. Okay. Some of these plant chemicals have been shown to be advantageous beneficial to human and animal health if consumed at appropriate amount. बट सम ऑफ ऐसे प्लांट केमिकल्स हैं जो आपके एडवांटेजियस या फिर बेनिफिशियल इफेक्ट शो करते हैं इफ वी आर कंज्यूम एट एप्रोप्रिएट अमाउंट. सो दीज आर द ओवरऑल समरी अबाउट एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल एंड एंटी न्यूट्रिएंट. होप इट्स क्लियर टू यू. इफ यू हैव एनी डाउट प्लीज ड्रॉप अ कमेंट ऑन कमेंट सेक्शन. देन on the basis of their stability, we divide the anti-nutritional factor in a two group. Basically, one is a heat stable group, other one is a heat liable group. So one by one, we can see what is the heat stable group. Basically, heat stable group is that particular anti-nutritional factors which are not destroyed by a high heat temperature, after which can maintain at high temperature. So that particular anti nutritional factor which is not affected by the high temperature or which is not degraded by the high temperature, high cooking temperature, high processing temperature, which is able to maintain her condition in a high temperature is known as a heat stable group. So heat stable group anti-nutritional factor including your phytic acid, polyphenolic compound such as condensed tannin, alkaloids, saponin and non-protein amino acids. Okay. Next one is a heat liable group. Heat liable group is sensitive to standard temperature and lost is high temperature. That means that type of anti-nutritional factor which are not stable in a high heat temperature, comes under the category of heat liable group. It's include lactin, cyanogenic, glycosides, protease inhibitor and toxic amino acids. So what we understand from this slide is that some of the anti-nutritional factor is not destroyed at a high temperature processing or high temperature cooking, whereas some anti-nutritional factor for some anti-nutrient is easily destroyed or easily lost its characteristic at a high temperature processing or high temperature cooking. So based on that, when we learn the mechanism how to remove these anti-nutritional factor from your food, it can very helpful. Hope it's clear to you. Then come to the next point. On the basis of their chemical structure, their specific action, further, anti-nutritional factor is divided into the four major classes. One is a protein, other one is a glycosides, other one is a phenols, and fourth one is a others. So one by one we can see in protein, anti-nutritional factor is divided into in protein categories. First one is a protease inhibitor, which further divided into trypsin inhibitor and chymotrypsin. Then another one is a hemagglutinins and amylase inhibitor, food allergens and toxic amino acids. In a category of glycosides, there are the major four anti-nutritional factor including saponins, cyanogens, estrogens and vitrogens. Then come to the next, which is a phenols. In a phenols category, there are two major anti-nutritional factors, which is a gazepol and tannin. Then in others category, we have anti-minerals, phytic acid, anti-vitamins and plant carcinogen. So we can see anti-nutritional factor are divided on the stability on high temperature or low temperature, and it can be further divided in the chemical structure and the specific action which they perform and about their it's based on also the biosynthetic origin of that particular anti-nutritional factor. So here we can identify what is the base on protein, what is the base on glycosidase, which one is the base on the phenols, and which one is classified in the other category. So by this hope it's clear to you that what is the anti-nutritional factor and what is the definition by in a scientific way, how can we define anti-nutritional factor, and then we classify anti-nutritional factor in a different categories. So hope these things are clear to you. Now let's come to the next point. What is the adverse effect of the anti-nutrient in our body? So there are some basic anti-nutrient which is in this phytate, oxalate, cyanidine, lactins, protease inhibitor and phenolic compounds. So in this slide we can see what is the adverse effect of that particular anti-nutritional factor in our body. After that we can discuss different type of anti-nutritional factor and their source as well. So here only the overview of that particular anti-nutrient and their effect on the body. So first anti-nutrient, that is phytate, and if we see what is the adverse effect of the phytate in our body, is it reduces the calcium and iron absorption in the body. So if the calcium and iron absorption is not properly in our body, then what will there is a hemoglobin deficiency, there is a bone related issue, because it reduces the calcium absorption as well. Then come to the next, that is oxalate. Oxalate is a anti-nutritional factor, and its adverse effect on body is that it also reduces the calcium absorption and increase kidney stone formation. That means when oxalate come in our body, then it's the come in contact with the calcium and make a complex substance, that is a calcium oxalate, which is not absorbed by the body, because body absorb only a calcium, not calcium oxalate. And these calcium oxalate is responsible for the kidney stone formation. So when oxalate containing foods is consumed by a human, then it's adversely effect on the calcium absorption, because it's bind with the calcium and make a substance that is known as a calcium oxalate. Okay, then other one is a cyanide. Cyanide is directly affect the respiratory system. And then come to the lactins, also known as the hemagglutinins. It's prevent the absorption of digestive end products in the small intestine. Basically, it's prevent the absorption of digestive and digestive end products in a small intestine, and by this there is a many digestion related problem, including constipation and sometimes diarrhea and other digestive system related diseases. Then come to the next, which is a protease inhibitor. Protease inhibitor adversely affect the body by the it's reduce the protein digestion. Protease inhibitor, that means it's adversely affect on the protein digestion. Okay, then come to the phenolic compounds. Phenolic compounds, aise compounds hote hain that reduce the bioavailability of some minerals, especially it's a very adversely affect on the zinc. It reduce the bioavailability of the minerals that is zinc, because it's reduce the absorption rate of zinc. Tannins are usually stable when confronted with heat, and they may negatively affect pH mechanism, reduce protein digestion. Because tannin is belongs to the phenolic compound, and tannins are usually stable, heat stable, and they may negatively affect the pH mechanism. Okay, and by negatively affect the pH mechanism, it also help in the reduce the protein digestion as well. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Now, come to the next. Based on the protein, as previously we will discuss, based on the protein, we classify a different antinutritional, in which amylase inhibitor, protease inhibitor, and hemagglutinin. So, amylase inhibitor is a different, and protease inhibitor including pepsin inhibitor, chymotrypsin, and hemagglutins including lactins, food allergens, and toxic amino acid, which is based on the chemical structure of that particular antinutritional factor. So, हम यहाँ पे इसको देखेंगे एक एक की characteristics क्या क्या हैं. If हम start करते हैं आपके protease inhibitor से, what is the mainly protease inhibitor and what is the function of that protease inhibitor in our body. So, these are the protein inhibitor are found in a various form present in the tissue of animal and plant as well in microorganism as well. So, these are these protein inhibitor is formed not only in a plant but it also found in the animal as well as in microorganism. This is the basically two types, in which trypsin inhibitor and chymotrypsin. So, these substances reduce protein digestion. They decompose with heat, and about 10 to 20% of the total acute trypsin is found in a human pancreatic juice. They bind proteases, which are resistant to digestion in the small intestine, and thus ensure their removal through extraction. Okay, they have ability to inhibit the activity of proteolytic enzymes within the gastrointestinal tract. Trypsin causes pancreatic enlargement and growth depression. When legumes are eaten raw or without being cooked properly, they upset digestive function and cause diarrhea or excessive gas. Okay? And then come to the amylase inhibitor. Amylase inhibitor are also known as starch blocker because they contain substances that prevent dietary starch from being absorbed by the body. Amylase inhibitor can reduce starch digestion. Active over a pH range of 4.5 to 9.5 and are a heat liable. Okay, autoclave treatment or boiling also reduce the quantity of these substances. Okay, so because amylase inhibitor is a heat liable and active at a pH range of 4.5 to 9.5, so if we are give this substance a high heat treatment, high cooking, high temperature cooking treatment, high temperature processing, autoclave treatment, then this quantity of these anti-nutritional factor it reduce and their activities also reduced by this action. Okay, next is the lactins, which is a hemagglutinins. So what is this lactins? Basically, lactins is prevent absorption of digestive in product in a small intestine. Okay, they enable the coagulation of red blood cells by affecting erythrocytes. It affects the function of erythrocytes, and erythrocyte is responsible for the coagulation of red blood cell. Okay, they may bind to carbohydrate moieties of cell of intestinal wall and cause a non-specific interference with nutrient absorption because they bind the carbohydrate moieties of the cell in intestinal wall, and by this there is a cause of a non-specific interference with nutrient absorption because in our body when we consume carbohydrate for the absorption and digestion of the carbohydrate start from the mouth. So in any form, if you consume carbohydrate, body converts in a glucose and then consume this energy because aapki body jo hai wo kisi bhi form mein carbohydrate ko lete hain, then it convert in a glucose, tabhi wo uska utilization aapki body mein hota hai. In any other form there is no utilization of the carbohydrate in our body, further it's convert into glucose. So when carbohydrate enter in the body, there is a these carbohydrate moieties of the cell in that lectin is the anti-nutritional factor that bind with the carbohydrate moieties of the cell, and there is a if they they bind the cell, there is a no proper absorption of the carbohydrate in our body. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Then come to the legumes are the main source of lectins in ordinary human food. Basically lectins जो होते हैं आपके लेग्यूम्स जो आप बेसिकली कंज्यूम करते हैं ऑर्गेनिक ह्यूमन फूड है जो आप लेग्यूम्स उसमें सबसे ज्यादा मिलता है. इसमें आपके प्लांट ग्लूटेनिन्स एंड फाइटोहेमोग्लूटेनिन्स प्रेजेंट होते हैं. ओके, देन कम टू द टॉक्सिक एमिनो एसिड. देयर इज अ मेनी एमिनो एसिड विच इज अ मोर टॉक्सिक एंड विच हैज द एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल प्रॉपर्टीज कॉमनली फाउंड इन लिथाइरस एंड ब्रॉड बीन्स. Dihydroxyphenylalanine, which is known as a DOPA, DOPA, basically found in the legumes, and this is responsible for the hemolytic anemia in humans by fava beans consumption, a condition known as a favism. Fava beans is the one type of legumes, which is in this. There is an anti-nutritional factor, dihydroxyphenylalanine is present, and this is the responsible for the hemolytic anemia in a human. And by consumption of fava beans, due to fava beans, this condition is known as a favism. Then come to the cannabinin. Cannabinin is found in the seed of legumes, okay, cisbania and jack beans. It is soluble in water and it is an arginine antagonistic. Okay, so by these all amino acid is act as a toxic amino acid in our body. Okay, now come to the allergens. Allergens is any substance that are generally found in the nutrients. They cause allergic reaction that are specific to the certain individual. Allergens are that compound which is not so allergic reaction in all the human. But some particular, some specific person is prone to some specific allergic reaction. Not all humans are prone to the allergic reaction with consuming that particular food. Okay, so the level of harm done depends on the sensitivity level of individual body rather than the quantity of the substance taken with the food. So that means, how sensitive the person is, the harm label, the level of harm is depend on that, not that the how much quantity you consume. Okay, diarrhea and vomiting are the symptoms of allergy. Protein with high molecular weight cause allergy, and histamine and compound of histamine derivative act as an antigens against allergen. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Now come to the other category, that is glycosidase. Glycosidase includes saponin, cyanogens, estrogens and goitrogens. So firstly, there is a saponin. So what is a saponin? Saponin are a heterogeneous group of naturally occurring foam producing triterpenes or steroid glycosidase that occur in a wide range of plant, including pulses and oil seeds such as kidney beans, lentil, pea, chickpea, etc. So saponin are basically present in a pulses and oil seed like kidney bean, lentil, pea, chickpea. Okay, what this cause? It causes the hypercholesterolemia by binding cholesterol, making it unavailable for absorption, cause hemolysis of red blood cells, and are toxic up to rat. Legume saponin have only moderate toxicity and present a problem only when present in the diet at higher concentration. Legume saponin have a moderate toxicity, and it's so toxic effect when we consume it's in higher concentration. In a limited concentration, if we consume the saponin containing product in a minimum amount, after saponin content of that in that particular food in a minimum concentration, then it's not lethal, it's not fatal, and it's not so some toxic effect as well. Thus, saponin can be considered as a resistance factor in legumes against microbial infection and herbivory. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Next is a cyanogen. Then what is a cyanogen? Cyanogens are glycosidase which consist HCN can come out as a result of hydrolysis. Okay, they are potentially toxic. Cyanide can be disintegrated with heat, and since it separates from legumes during cooking or washing, it will be beneficial to pour soaking water. Then what is HCN? Is a potent respiratory inhibitor which is present in a lima bean containing 20 to 30 milligram per 100 gram. So by this we can assume how much this is a toxic, because in 100 gram there is a 20 to 30 milligram present HCN in that lima bean. Okay, occur in a several important food plants and legumes including cassava, chickpea, kidney bean, lima bean, hyacinth bean, broad bean, pigeon pea, jack bean, and the oil seeds such as linseed. So आपने अभी तक जितने भी एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर देखे होंगे, वन थिंग इज कॉमन, दैट इज मेनली ऑलमोस्ट 80 to 85% एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर इज डायरेक्टली बिलोंग्स टू द लेग्यूम्स एंड सीरियल्स. Most of the anti-nutritional factors in present in the legumes and cereals. In the legumes and cereals, there is a major contribution of legumes in the anti-nutritional factor. Okay. Then come to the estrogens. What is estrogens? Estrogens are phytoestrogen or compound exhibiting estrogenic activity and found in wheat, rice, chickpea, alfalfa, lupin, groundnut, linseed, and soybean. These compounds exhibit estrogenic activity in soybean have been identified as isoflavones, including genistein, diazine, cumesterol, of which genistein is the most prominent. It's cause growth inhibition, elevated level of zinc in the liver and bones, and increased deposition of calcium, phosphorus, magnesium in the bone. So, dry or moist heat treatment or solvent extraction can achieve inactivation of estrogens. So, basically estrogens are destroyed by the dry or moist heat treatment or by solvent extraction. But what if this is directly present in a food, then it causes growth inhibition. And what one thing you notice, all the other nutrients is reduce the level of certain nutrient, but it elevated the level of zinc in the liver and bones and increased the deposition of calcium, phosphorus, and magnesium in bone. So we all know that deficiency and over nutrient of certain vitamins or minerals is also toxic. So other anti-nutritional factor act as the reduce the absorption of certain nutrients, certain vitamins and minerals, and estrogens. What does estrogens? Estrogens does the increase the deposition of certain vitamins and minerals. Okay, hope it's clear to you. And now come to the next point, which is a goitrogens. Goitrogens is a belongs to the family of cruciferous vegetables. Cruciferous vegetables including soybean contains glycosidase called goitrogens. Glucose enolates these glycosides cause the thyroid glands to grow by inhibiting the iodine intake of the thyroid gland. It's inhibiting the iodine intake by thyroid gland because of this thyroid gland is level of and size of the thyroid gland is increased, and that come to the lead to the disease which is known as a goiter, and because of this these 13 anti-nutrients, the factor is known as a goitrogens because it causing the goitrogens disease. These toxic effect can be reduced with the addition of iodine to the diet. They can found in a broccoli, Brussels sprout, cabbage and cauliflower. Basically, goitrogens present in a broccoli, cabbage and cauliflower. And how can we reduce the effect of that goitrogens? Only by the addition of iodine in our diet, extra addition of iodine on our diet, we can reduce the toxic effect of the goitrogens. Okay, because it directly inhibit the iodine intake. So if we consume iodine properly, take iodine in our diet properly, then we can reduce the toxic effect of that particular anti-nutritional factor. Okay, then come to the phenols. In phenols there are two, one is the gossypol and other one is the tannins. So firstly, if we can see the gossypol is a naturally occurring polyphenolic compound which is present in the pigment gland of cottonseed, and it reduces lysine availability, has been reported with cottonseed protein due to the ability of gossypol to bind with the reactive amino group of lysine during heat processing. It's directly bind with the reactive group of lysine during heat processing, and by this it's reduce the lysine availability in the body. Toxic symptom of gossypol are depressed appetite, lower weight gain and cardiac irregularity is also seen. The effect of gossypol can be reduced by adding ferrous sulfate to the diet. If we add ferrous sulfate in our diet, we can reduce the effect of gossypol. Okay. Now come to the tannins. What is the tannins? Tannins is basically a polyphenol compound, but on hydrolysis they yield sugar residue, phenolic carboxylic acid and condensed tannin. There are two type of tannins. One is a condensed tannin, which is a more stable, and other one is a hydrolyzable tannins, which is easily broken down. So tannins are the group of compound that bind to protein, including dietary protein, digestive enzyme and protein, which assist in nutrient absorption in the gut. Heating is less effective as tannins are heat stable. So heat treatment for the reduction of this tannin is not very much effective because tannins are heat stable. So come to the next point, which is the water soluble polyphenols that are widely distributed in nature, food, crops and legumes, including significant quantities of tannins are sorghum containing up to 5% condensed tannin, fava bean and lima bean and sunflower seed meal contain 1.2 to 2.7% of that, and carboxylic acid and rapeseed. Okay. Then come to the other anti-nutritional factor, which includes anti-minerals, phytic acid, oxalate, anti-vitamins and anti-enzyme. So first we can see that in our skin there is a phytic acid. So let's learn about the phytic acid and its action. So phytic acid is hexaphosphate of myo-inositol, and legumes is found in the legumes and oilseed, including soybean, rapeseed, cottonseed. It's mainly found in a 62 to 73% in a cereal grain, and 46 to 73% in legume seed. Total phosphorus being in a form of originally found phytic phosphorus. Okay, major part of the phosphorus contained within phytic acid being largely unavailable to animal. Phytic acid acts as a strong chelator, forming protein and mineral phytic acid complex. By this, it reduces the protein and minerals by availability because phytic acid is act as a strong chelator and is bind with the protein and minerals and some metal ion. As we know, there is a if you talk about the additive, food additives, there is a one range of additive which is known as a chelating agent and scavenging agent. So same as the function of that chelating agent which we are added in that particular food for binding with that some metal ion, there is a same action performed by the phytic acid in human body. It's formed because it's the strong chelating agent, and this phytic acid forming a complex structure, complex phytic acid complex with form a bond with protein, minerals and some metal ions. And when it form the bond with protein, minerals and make a complex structure, then the absorption of these particular food is reduced, because there is a other form. Body is not absorb these compound in a different form. So it form a different complex compound which is not absorbed by the body, and by this it reduce the protein and mineral availability in the body. Okay, phytic acid chelates metal ions such as calcium, magnesium, zinc, copper ion and molybdenum to form insoluble complex that are not readily absorbed from the gastrointestinal tract. इसका सेम फंक्शन आपके चिलेटिंग एजेंट की तरह होता है. जैसे कि चिलेटिंग एजेंट फूड में एक बेनिफिशियल इफेक्ट देने के लिए वी कैन ऐड दैट चिलेटिंग एजेंट, बट इन अ ह्यूमन बॉडी इट्स द अनवांटेड चिलेटिंग एजेंट विच इज अ फाइटिक एसिड. एंड इफ यू कंज्यूम दिस फाइटिक एसिड देन इट्स गोड इन आवर बॉडी एंड दे फॉर्म द कॉम्प्लेक्स स्ट्रक्चर विथ प्रोटीन एंड मिनरल्स. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Now come to the next, that is oxalate. Oxalate bind the calcium and form a calcium oxalate which is insoluble and prevents its absorption in the human body, and it's responsible for the also kidney stone. So sewer are fatal human poisoning by eating a large quantity of the leaves of certain plants which contain oxalate, including rhubarb, member of the Spanish family. Cinnamon, sesame, green leafy vegetables and wood apple include have the oxalate in their leaves. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Then come to the next point, that is the anti-vitamin factor. So there are many anti-vitamin factor depend upon the categories of vitamin, like vitamin A, anti-vitamin A, anti-vitamin D, anti-vitamin E, anti-vitamin K and so on. So what is anti-vitamin K? Anti-vitamin A factor present in soybean which destroy carotene and is not readily absorbed by heat. So anti-vitamin factor which is present in soybean, it affects the carotene availability. It destroys the carotene, and we all know that carotene is a precursor of vitamin A, because we cannot directly take a vitamin A with food. We take carotene, and when we take the carotene, carotene go in a liver, and there is a vitamin A synthesis in the liver. So anti-vitamin A factor which is present in soybean which destroy the carotene. So when the carotene is destroyed, how can body prepare the vitamin E? So indirectly it affects the availability of vitamin A in our body. So this is known as an anti-vitamin factor, anti-vitamin A factor specifically. Then come to the anti-vitamin D factor. Anti-vitamin D factor present in a soybean with interface with the calcium and phosphorus absorption, and it destroyed by autoclaving. Okay. Then anti-vitamin E factor which is present in kidney beans, soybean, alfalfa, field pea, it's causing liver necrosis and muscular dystrophy, and it destroyed by the autoclaving as well. Other one is an anti-vitamin K factor which is present in a sweet clover. Then next one is an anti-thiamine factor which is present in a cotton seed, linseed, mung bean and mustard seed. Then other category is the anti-niacin factor which is present in a sorghum, anti-pyridoxine factor which is present in linseed which is destroyed by water extraction and autoclaving, anti-vitamin B12 factor present in a raw soya bean. Okay, so these anti-vitamin factors is directly or indirectly affect the availability of that vitamin in our body. So by this, it's produce adverse health effects in our body. Okay, hope it's clear to you. If any doubt, you can comment your doubt in a comment section. Okay, then come to the anti-enzymes. What is the anti-enzymes? Anti-enzymes is the cholinesterase inhibitor solanine present in a green potatoes, which is a heat stable and water soluble. Solanine is also known as a carcinogenic compound. Amylase inhibitor present in wheat, oat and rye, and arginase inhibitor present in sunflower seed, which is a derivative of chlorogenic acid. So anti-enzyme is directly affect the enzymatic activity of that enzyme. Okay, then come to the alkaloids. What is the alkaloids? Some of the more well-known alkaloids present in a certain food, including nicotine, which is present in tobacco, quinine, which is present in a cinchona bark. Other one is a solanine, which is present in unripe potatoes and potato sprouts. Reducing the toxic effect of these alkaloids is either by removing them by aqueous extraction, like solanine extraction from potatoes by hot water, or arginine oil toxin due to an alkaloid present in sanguinine. In exam mein sabse zyada arginine oil toxin pucha jata hai, usme pucha jata hai ki kis alkaloid ki wajah se arginine oil toxicity show karta hai. So the anti-nutritional factor which is present in arginine oil is sanguinine. Okay, then come to the toxic effect including vomiting, diarrhea, irregular fever and anorexia sometimes. Okay, hope it's clear to you what is the effect of alkaloids and where it is formed. Then there is some list of the food stuff and other anti-nutritional factor which is found in that particular food. So if you talk about the soybean meal, in soybean meal there is a many anti-nutritional factor which is present, including trypsin inhibitor, lectins, oligosaccharides, phytic acid. If you are talking about pea, in a pea there are many anti-nutritional factors which including lectins, tannins, oligosaccharides. Like this, rapeseed meal also included anti-nutritional factor, also containing anti-nutritional factor which is a glucose, enolate, tannins, phenolic acids. Then other one is a lupine. Lupine contain anti-nutritional factor which is alkaloids. Then sunflower meal contain tannins. Wheat contain phytic acid, polyphenols, tannins and saponin. Barley containing beta-glucans, and some wild edible plant including Buchenia, Rachimosha, including oxalate, phytate and tannins. Oxalate also found in a spinach as well. Okay, hope it's clear to you. Then there is an anti-nutritional factor which is present in a certain pulses. So here the we can divide in a major three categories: pulses and legumes name, their botanical name and their anti-nutritional factor which is present in that particular piece or legumes. So this particular side is very important for your any exam point of view and your basic understanding about the anti-nutritional factor. So if you talk about the broad beans contain Vicia fava, broad beans, botanical name of broad beans Vicia fava, and anti-nutritional factor which is present in a broad bean known as fava bean is protease inhibitor. Okay, then phytic acid, phytohemagglutinin and tannins as well. Okay, then come to the chickpea which is also known as a Bengal gram, and botanical name of it, this is a Sisal eritina. It is a protease inhibitor. Cyanogens also present in this, and phytic acid, saponin and estrogens as well. Cowpea, botanical name of cowpea is a Vigna unguiculta, and anti-nutritional factor which is present in cowpea is protease inhibitor, phytic acid and phytohemagglutinin. Then kidney bean, known as a Falcius vulgaris, and it's include is containing protease inhibitor, phytic acid, phytic hemagglutinin, cyanogen, saponin, anti-vitamin E factor, and amylase inhibitor. Then mung bean, green bean is containing protease inhibitor, phytic acid, saponin, antithymine factor. Field pea, which is known as a Pisum sativum, is include protease inhibitor, cyanogens, phytohemagglutinin, phytic acid, saponin, antivitamin E factor. These are the anti-nutritional factor which is found in a field pea. Then come to the pigeon pea, which is known as a Ganglius tangens, which is include, which is contained protease inhibitor as anti-nutritional factor, cyanogens, as well as phytohemagglutinin and phytic acid. Black gram is containing protease inhibitor, trypsin, chymotrypsin, and phytic acid. So, from this only this slide, there is a chance that many questions is arriving in your examination. So, you can take a screenshot of this particular slide. You can reverse back the video and again play the video and see all these things, and you can pause the video and note down these pulses, legumes, and what particular pulses and legumes contain anti-nutritional factor. You can note down. It's up to you how it's easy for you. Okay, then other one is an anti-nutritional factor which is present in a certain oil seed. There is a many oil seed like groundnut, trap seed, Indian mustard, cotton seed, linseed, soybean, and sesame. So one by one we can take. In a groundnut, anti-nutritional factor present is protease inhibitor, phytic acid, saponin, estrogenic factor. Okay, if you talk about the rapeseed containing protease inhibitor, glucosinolate, phytic acid, and tannins. Then come to the Indian mustard, which is known as a Brassica junica. It includes protease inhibitor, glucosinolate, and antithiamine factor. Cotton seed, which is known as a Gaussium species, and it's containing phytic acid, estrogenic factor, and anti-vitamin E factor. If you talk about the linseed is known as a Linum UC tetisum, and is containing cyanogens, phytic acid, estrogenic factor, antithiamine factor, antipyridoxic factor as an anti-nutritional factor. Soybean, you can see there are many anti-nutritional factors found in a soybean. So it's include protease inhibitor, glucosinolate, phytohemagglutinin, phytic acid, saponin, estrogenic factor, anti-vitamin E factor, anti-vitamin A factor, anti-vitamin D factor, anti-vitamin B12 factor, and allergens. So by this you can assume how much toxic is soybean. It's high in protein, but it is containing number of anti-nutritional factors. Then come to the other, which is a sesame. Sesame include the phytic acid one. Now, what is the method of elimination of particular anti-nutritional factor? So, there are many methods by which we can eliminate the anti-nutrient by our food. So, elimination of anti-nutritional factor method include the post-harvest processing, then chemical detoxification, one by genetic engineering, and other one through genetic modification of particular crop. Okay, by this we can eliminate the anti-nutrients factor which is present in particular food. And what we can in a post-harvest processing, including cooking, by which we can remove second one is a soaking, germination, fermentation. Third one is a drying. Fourth one is a autoclaving, steaming. And fifth one is a combination of domestic processing with chemical method by which we can remove these anti-nutritional factor. This comes in the category of post-harvest processing. Okay. Then we can see what is the effect of different cooking methods. methods on the anti-nutritional factor of lentil seed. So here is the treatment, here is the reduction of trypsin inhibitor, here is the tannin, here is the fatty acid. We can see what is the effect of this. If you can say, if you consume raw, there is a no treatment, then trypsin inhibitor concentration is 2.8, 1.28 concentration of tannin, and 4.11 is the concentration of fatty acid. If you are treating, yani ki if you are boiling these, so what is, there is a trypsin inhibitor reduced 2.83 by 0.15, okay, yani ki major decrease ho raha hai aapka if you are boiling treatment aap de raha ho. Tannin ke case mein it's also reduced, one pehle kya tha 1.28, then it's come to the 0.91. In a phytic acid, it's also reduced by 2%, 4.11 tha, yahan pe 2.6 ho gaya. And then come to the autoclaving, if you are treated with autoclave, then what is the effect? There is a, in a trypsin inhibitor, we can see there is a major effect of boiling. And in a case of a tannin, there is a major effect of tannins, because tannin is majorly reduced by the autoclaving treatment. And phytic acid is as well, it's reduced by the autoclaving. In the microwave cooking, there is a not that effective. There is a reduce in the concentration, but in not that way, which is a trypsin inhibitor by boiling and tannin and phytic acid by autoclaving. So by this you can easily interpret that what is the effect of certain treatment condition in a certain anti-nutritional factor. All the anti-nutritional factor is not reduced by the one particular treatment. Okay, so come to the next point. Here is the effect of cooking on the anti-nutritional factor of lima bean. There is a lima bean which is known as a Fulcius lentus. So yahan pe hum iska dekh rahe hain ki isne, if we are trying to reduce the anti-nutritional factor of lima bean, so what is the effect of that cooking treatment on lima bean as well? So if you are taking the sample of raw bean, cooked lima bean sample for 60 minutes, cooked lima bean for 120 minutes, and cooked for 160 minutes. So here you can see easily, phytic acid is, if cooked on 160 minutes, there is a major reduce of phytic acid, which is 88.5 plus minus 3.6, and you can easily see in a lima bean, there is a, if you cooked a lima bean in a certain duration, which is a 160 minute, if you are cooked for 160 minute lima bean, then there is a phytic acid, hydrocyanic acid, and total phenols is reduced by major reduction is seen in this condition. Okay, so from this we can interpret that if you want to reduce the anti-nutritional factor in a lima bean, then cooking time is must have 160 minutes. Okay, tannins in lima bean, tannins is easily reduced by 0.0195 from 0.59 milligram on average cooking duration, which is 120 minutes. So tannin is reduced in a shorter duration other than a phytic acid, hydrocyanic acid, and total polyphenols. Okay, then come to the effect of processing on in vitro protein digestibility of lima bean. In vitro protein digestibility, if you take in vitro, if you cooked for 160 minutes, in vitro condition protein digestibility is major, which is 84.6 plus minus 1.5. in other condition, if you consume raw, there is a protein digestibility level is less, which is only 43%. If you cooked for its 60 minutes, in that condition, it's there is an increase in protein digestibility, but not as much as if you cooked at the 160 minute. So from this slide we can interpret it, if you cook the lima bean at certain temperature by in a duration of 160 minutes, then protein digestibility of that particular food which with particular lima bean product, there is a 84% from 43% increase, 84% digestibility of protein. Okay, so there is a many effect of boiling on a anti-nutritional factor which is present in yam. There is a many other specific example which is not important for us, so we can skip this. Okay, effect of soaking anti-nutritional factor and protein digestibility. So this is the important, first is the soaking period and how it affects on the certain anti-nutritional factor. So here is the soaking period 0 to 6, 12 and 18 hours. There is a certain phytic acid present and there is a also so how the protein digestibility. If you soak mung bean basically, so if you soak mung bean for 0 hours, there is a phytic acid concentration is more, which is 740. If you soak it for the 18 hours, then phytic acid concentration is less, which is 519, which is reduced by 30. Okay, in case of polyphenols, we soak mung bean for 18 hours, there is a reduction, huge reduction in a polyphenols as well, reduction of 11 milligram. Okay, then if we talk about the saponin concentration, saponin is also reduced by 7. If you increase the soaking period of a certain product, that is a mung bean, by 0 to 18, and it's also impact the protein digestibility also, because protein digestibility percentage is also increased. It's increased by plus 21. Okay, so you can easily interpret that how cooking, soaking and germination is reduce the concentration of anti-nutritional factor in a certain food, basically in a legumes. Okay, by this way sprouted legumes, sprouted grains are very helpful and very healthy, because by soaking, by germination, we reduce the anti-nutritional factor of that particular food, and by reduction of that particular anti-nutritional factor in that particular food, we increase the bioavailability of certain vitamins, minerals which is present in that particular food, and it's more healthy for our health. Okay, then come to the next point, which is what is the cooking effect of protein digestibility. We can, it's not as important. Okay, this slide is going to be important. Anti-nutritional factor in different cereal brand में अगर देखें, wheat brand में आपका anti-nutritional factor की यहाँ पे quantity दी हुई है, ठीक है? तो you can take a screenshot of this, ठीक है? अगर ये full fat है, तो इसमें कितना anti-nutritional factor है? And if it's defatted, then what is the anti-nutritional factor concentration? So you can easily see that in a full fat, there is a full fat wheat bran, rice bran, barley bran, there is a concentration of phytic acid, polyphenols, tannins, oxalates, saponin and trypsin. It's all the concentration of these is high, but if we defatted the these bran, then concentration of phytic acid, polyphenol, tannin and oxalate is reduced. So in some case there is a major reduction, and some case like if you take the trypsin inhibitor, there is a minor reduction, but reduction is shown in comparison to full fat to defatted. Okay, so now come to the anti-nutritional factor, which is Bambara groundnut. We can not take this because not as important as other. Okay, so what is the basically blanching effect on a oxalic acid contained on the green leafy vegetables. So there is a treatment, and there is a substance that is amaranth, bathua, fenugreek, and spinach, which have the oxalic acid in their food. So there is a blanching. If you blanch for 5 minutes, there is a reduction of oxalic acid by 6.7 in amaranth, and in a bathua is also reduced. In the fenugreek is we can see it's also reduced by 0.91 to 0.58. In spinach, it's also reduced by 14.92 to 8.38. So if we see that if we increase the duration of blanching by 5 minutes to 10 minutes to 15 minutes, there is a huge reduction is shown in the concentration of that particular oxalic acid in that particular food commodity. Okay, beyond blanching, there is a cooking. If we cook in open pan, there is also the reduction in certain concentration of oxalic acid, but not as effective as a blanching. Okay, so by this you can interpret it. If you want, you can take a screenshot, you can note down by pausing the video. Okay. यहाँ पे चिकपी का दिया हुआ है, बट वी कैन नॉट डिस्कस इट बिकॉज इट्स नॉट एज इम्पोर्टेंट. देन कम टू द कंक्लूजन. सो बाय दिस वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट ऑल प्रोसेसिंग ट्रीटमेंट वेर इफेक्टिव इन द रिडक्शन ऑफ एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर. हाउएवर प्रेशर कुकिंग वॉज फाउंड टू बी बेस्ट फॉर रिमूवल ऑफ एंटी न्यूट्रिशनल फैक्टर. The processing treatment have significant effect on chemical composition, mineral content, and free fatty acid and protein digestibility. Blanching and cooking result in significant reduction in oxalic acid. Only blanching result in significant reduction in phytic acid and polyphenol content. Blanching and sprouting were found to be the best method in order to reduce the contents of anti-nutritional factor. The anti-nutrient are more susceptible to moist heat than dry heat. Okay. Then other is the germination and fermentation are potential process to improve mineral extractability and decrease anti-nutrient which bind minerals and reduce their availability. In some pulses, soaking before cooking is the most traditional, economic and appropriate method to reduce anti-nutrient. Today, a deeper knowledge of the chemical structure of the anti-nutrient involved can help to devise technological strategy to propose legume seed in order to obtain toxin-free products. Okay. Most of the toxic and anti-nutrient effect of these compounds in a food could be removed by several processing methods such as soaking, germination, boiling, autoclaving, fermentation, genetic manipulation, and other processing methods, but extensive research is still needed to discover elimination methods for heat-stable anti-nutrient, because heat-liable anti-nutrient is easily reduced or destroyed by the blanching condition. If we give them a heating treatment by fermentation or by different cooking temperature, but heat stable anti-nutrient is not easily eliminated. So for this, there is a still research is needed for the elimination of anti-nutrient factor, which is heat stable, is present in a various food without altering the nutritional value of that particular food. Okay, this is the important. So this is all about the anti-nutritional factor. Hope you like the session. If you like the session, please subscribe our channel, like our video, and share with your friends and colleagues. So thank you for watching.